Assalamu alaikum and good morning. Hope everybody is fine at home. We will continue our topic of retinal vascular diseases. We have already discussed diabetic retinopathy and retinal vein occlusion. And today we are going to discuss about the retinal arterial occlusive disease. As far as the etiology is concerned, the most important cause is atherosclerosis, thrombus formation and subsequent embolism. This is the most important cause. The other important cause is inflammation in or around the vessel, like in cases of giant cell arteritis and systemic lupus erythematosus. The third important cause is vasospasm that occurs in cases of retinal migraine. The fourth one is thrombophilic disorders, like in cases of hyperhomocysteinemia, antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. This is important in younger patients. So whenever you encounter a patient who comes with retinal artery occlusion, we have to rule out this one, the hyperhomocysteinemia, antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. There can be inherited defects of various anticoagulation factors, and it is also not uncommon in sickle cell disease. So we need to rule out the sickling hemoglobinopathies also. These are the different kinds of emboli that can cause retinal arterial occlusion. It can be branch retinal artery occlusion, it can be central retinal artery occlusion. The first one is this cholesterol emboli. These are yellowish white and they usually occur at the site of arterial bifurcation. The second one is the calcific emboli that we can see. These are whitish in color and we can see these one on optic nerve head. The third one is the fibrinoplatelet. These are the fibrinoplatelet elongated. They usually, the source is usually the heart, and they occur in cases of atrial myxoma, bacterial endocarditis and valvular heart disease. After etiology, we need to do the systemic assessment in these patients. All the patients who are coming to us with central retinal artery occlusion or branch retinal artery occlusion, we need to refer these patients for the cardiovascular evaluation, to the cardiologist or internist. And in the history, the important thing is we need to ask about the smoking, we need to ask about the diabetes, hypertension, we need to ask about the intake of contraceptives or any lipid lowering agents. We have to ask about the symptoms regarding giant cell arteritis, such as jaw claudication, headache and scalp tenderness. The central retinal artery occlusion or branch retinal artery occlusion secondary to the giant cell arteritis usually occur in the older age groups. The patients are older than 60 years of age. You have to look for the pulse and to detect arrhythmias. This is very much uncommon in patients who have got atrial fibrillations. Have to do the cardiac auscultation to look for the murmurs, to look for any valvular disease. And of course, we have to check the blood pressure also to look for the hypertension. There are certain investigations we have to do in all the patients, and certain investigations we need to do only in the selected patients. In all the patients, we need to do the ECG to look for the arrhythmias and to look for the hypertension. We have to do the ESR and CRP for giant cell arteritis, CBC and random blood sugar and urea and electrolytes. Carotid duplex scanning to look for the carotid stenosis. In selected patients, we have to do the MRI and CT scan of the brain and the orbit to rule out any intracranial or orbital pathology. Chest X-ray we have to do for the tuberculosis and sarcoidosis, because these two conditions causes retinal vasculitis, which can subsequently lead to the retinal arterial occlusive disease. Echocardiography to look for any cardiac valvular pathology or in cases of bacterial endophthalmitis. and we have to do 24-hour heart monitoring with the Holter to look for any arrhythmias, occasional arrhythmias. We have to look for, in younger patients, the plasma homocysteine level, antiphospholipid antibodies, and we have to do the thrombophilia screen, plasma protein electrophoresis for multiple myeloma, thyroid function test if atrial fibrillation is present, autoantibodies in conditions like in cases of rheumatoid arthritis, suspected rheumatoid arthritis, we have to do the RA factor and anti-nuclear antibodies. These two conditions are also for the to rule out any collision vascular disorders, because these collision vascular disorders, they cause retinal vasculitis, and this retinal vasculitis again can cause arterial occlusive disease. Syphilis serology in a selected patient and blood cultures in patients with bacterial endocarditis. Now we will look for the different types of retinal occlusion. First of all, we look for the branch artery occlusion. In the branch artery occlusion, branch retinal artery occlusion, the presenting complaint is sudden and profound visual field defect with variable visual acuity. Because this usually does not involve the macula, so the patient is not going to have any central visual loss. Rather, the patient is going to say that he has got a visual field defect. Like in this case, we can see the edematous retina inferiorly, and we can see the embolus here also, and compare this area, this edematous area, with the normal retina. So we can say this is because of the inferior retina artery occlusion, and the patient is going to have the superior visual field defect. On examination, relative afferent pupillary defect is often present, and there is narrowing of the arteries and veins with segmentation of the blood column, and there is cloudy edematous retina as we can see here, and we can see the embolus here also into the retinal artery. In investigation, we have to do the fundus fluorescein angiography, which shows delay in the arterial filling and hypofluorescence of the involved segments. See, these arteries are not perfused. The rest of the arteries are perfused, and this is superior retinal artery, supratemporal retinal artery, and this area is hypofluorescent as compared to the rest of the retina. And this is the fundus photograph of the same patients, and here we can see this is cloudy retina and this is the normal retina. We need to follow these patients of branch retinal artery occlusion after every 3 months to review for the appearance of the fundus. For any reperfusion or any improvement, we have to look for the visual improvement in the visual fields and to provide advice on prognosis, whether the patient is going to have improvement in his or her visual fields, or he is going to have the same, and to confirm for the systemic management whether it has been done properly or not. The second one is the central retinal artery occlusion. Here the presenting complaint is severe sudden painless loss of vision because it involves the macula, and on examination there is profound relative afferent pupillary defect. There is cherry red spot at the macula, this one, the central cherry red spot at the macula. The rest of the retina is edematous. You can see the narrowing of the blood vessel, there is segmentation of the blood in blood column, and this area is pink because of the choroidal, intact choroidal vessels, because the fovea is the thinnest portion of the retina, so the intact choroidal vessels see through this area, and the retina is swollen and opaque in the peripapillary area, rather the rest of the area also, and we can see the emboli in 20% of the cases. Normal macula in cases of ciliaretinal artery, in cases of intact ciliaretinal artery, 20% of the normal population, they receive their macular blood supply from the ciliary circulation through ciliaretinal artery, and if there is fovea is intact and it is being supplied by the ciliaretinal artery, the patient may have the normal central vision in cases of even central retinal artery occlusion. And we need to follow the patients after a month to look for any incipient neovascularization, because this neovascularization can lead to the neovascular glaucoma, and we have to look for the investigations and for the systemic review also. Third one is the ciliaretinal artery occlusion. Ciliaretinal artery is present in 20% of the normal population. Its main importance is preservation of the central vision in cases of central retinal artery occlusion. It supplies macula and papillomacular bundle. Here we can see the opaque retina, the edematous retina. Again, this picture is opaque and edematous peripheral retina because of the ciliaretinal artery occlusion. The ciliaretinal artery occlusion can be isolated, or it is sometimes combined with anterior ischemic optic neuropathy, or combined with central retinal artery occlusion. See here in this picture, this is combined with central retinal artery occlusion. We can see the edematous retina here because of the ciliaretinal artery occlusion, and we can see the features of the central retinal vein occlusion. There is dilated tortuous veins, and there is flame-shaped hemorrhages, peripapillary flame-shaped hemorrhages. Presenting complaint is acute severe loss of central vision. There is cloudiness in the corresponding part of the retina, and FFA shows corresponding Philly defect, like in this picture. See the hypofluorescent area. This is because of the filling defect. The retinal artery is not perfused in this area. How can we treat a case of acute retinal artery occlusion? Retinal artery occlusion is basically one of the ocular emergency, and we need to treat the patient as soon as possible. The retinal damage is done if we delay the treatment more than 4 to 6 hours. So we have to do the treatment as soon as possible. Treatment should be commenced. Treatment is effective if we do this treatment before 24 hours or within 4 to 6 hours. Ocular massage we have to do to clasp the arterial lumen mechanically to dislodge the embolus, and the other maneuvers are to actually do the vasodilatation to increase the retinal perfusion, or to reduce the intraocular pressure again to increase the retinal perfusion. So to reduce the intraocular pressure, we have to do the interior chamber paracentesis. Paracentesis means we remove the aqueous humor through the interior chamber with a needle. We have to start topical and systemic anti-glaucoma treatment to reduce the intraocular pressure. We can give to the patient sublingual isosorbide dinitrate to induce vasodilatation. The other one is easier, and this is rebreathing in a paper bag to alleviate blood carbon dioxide, so that it will lead to the vasodilatation. And breathing in a high oxygen 95% and carbon dioxide mixture 5%, you know, this has a dual effect of retarding ischemia and causing vasodilatation. Hyperosmotic agents again to reduce the intraocular pressure. In some cases, anti-YAG laser embolysis, we can cause the embolus to break with the help of anti-YAG lasers. Thrombolysis we can do in selective patients. Treatment we have to do the systemic prophylaxis also following retinal artery occlusion for the other eyes, actually to stop smoking, and urgent referral to the cardiologist for evaluation. We can start antiplatelet therapy if there is no contraindication. Oral anticoagulation, warfarin, of course, need to be started by the cardiologist or internist, and we can do the carotid end arterectomy in cases of carotid stenosis more than 70%. Thank you so much.